Welcome back, everyone, to Four Eyes, the podcast series that gives you a clear view into the optometry world across Canada and the US. We are your hosts. My name is Dr. Amrit Bilku.
Hi, I'm Dr. Deepan Kar.
Hi, I'm Dr. Ravinder Rindawa.
And I'm Dr. Alex Kuhn.
And we're back.
Yay!
Finally. Finally.
We are back.
After a long, long, much needed break, I think so. You know, I'm really happy that we're finally back because we did push back our episodes a little bit because we were just enjoying, you know, post lockdown a little too much, which I'm sure everyone was this summer. I feel like this summer was the summer of last year and this year, like combined, like everyone missed last summer. And so everyone just kind of shoved all their plans into the last like 2 months. Before we even dive into the episode today, since it's been a long time, why don't we all just go around and update you guys on what we've been up to since the last season? Who wants to go first?
Mine's probably the easiest.
Yeah. Oh yeah.
I moved back to Calgary from Lethbridge, working here now, and I got a little puppy. So yay.
Wallace. Yay. We just saw Wallace before this episode.
Yeah, Wallace,
he's
a little labradoodle, 2 months. Yeah, so he's keeping me busy.
Yeah.
He's so
and
cute.
You're working at Sphere now with Dr. Danielle Gordon.
Yes, she was on our podcast about how she opened up her practice, Sphere Optometry. So I'm working there, and I love it so far. So shout out to Dr. Danielle Gordon. But yeah.
Are you still looking for one more job, like to just
I was working at Sphere and I was working at this clinic just outside of Calgary.
You remember she was working at two? Yeah.
Yeah. So I was working at that one. You won't believe like the schedule and it was crazy like what they basically did to me. So Rav, I told you it was the 20%.
Yeah, yeah, right? Yeah.
And Amrit, I told you that too. Yeah. So you guys are used to that, right? Or you guys know what that is. And Alex, you know, like the 20%.
This is 20% overall.
Overall, right? So I was like, okay, I've never had that before. I've always had a minimum or whatever. I was like, this is not okay. I don't know how much I'm making day to day. Like I just moved back. I need to figure out like what's going on. There would be, so the first week I worked there, it was fine. Like I was booked. It was all good. Second week, they cut my schedule in half and I saw like two people and I was like,
why did they cut it? Like,
because there was not enough patients. The next week I went, they completely cut my schedule, like my day off. They were like, oh, you can have the day off. I'm like, no, I don't want the day off. I'm capable to work today. So I want to work. And she was like, well, you have no patients. I'm like, okay. And then I quickly emailed the office manager and I was like, look, like I want consistent days on these like Thursdays and Fridays, like, and they're like, yeah, that'll work, don't worry about it, blah, blah, blah. Then when I was like looking at my schedule, I talked to the office manager and she's like, yeah, we can't do full-time, or no, we can't give you a consistent schedule on Thursdays and Fridays because we have to give our full-time doctors priority. And I was like, oh, I wasn't aware of this. If I knew that, I wouldn't have taken this position.
Yeah.
I was like stressing all of September. I was like, oh shit, no one bought glasses day. I just made like $100.
Welcome to my life.
I know. And I was telling my parents, like, I was like, I have Amrit's life now. So now guess what? I have five jobs, I think.
Four.
Yeah.
Dude, that's me. I don't have a minimum at any job. Like, ours is more like you don't get a daily minimum at like those corporate jobs, but then the percentage is obviously way higher. Like you'll make 50 to 60% of the eye exam.
Yeah. Remember when we started optometry school and remember we had we were laughing about how I was like, yo, when we graduate, we're only going to make 30,000 a year. That was almost true for me, yo. That was almost true. So it's possible to make 30 grand a year as an optometrist working full time. Okay.
Who's next? Alex, what have you been up to? I haven't heard from you at all.
I know. Well, Jordan and I went to our honeymoon in Hawaii, so that was great.
Ooh.
Yeah. We went moose hunting, me, my dad, and my brother, and we got one. So
ooh,
that's good.
Ooh. How big? Yep.
54 and a half antler to antler, like the longest part of the antler.
Wait, like so how do you guys process them, or like what do you guys use all the parts for?
Well, what we do is we get roasts made, and so they'll take different parts of the moose and make roasts out of it, and then we do ground moose, and so it's kind of like hamburger meat, basically.
Oh, does it taste like hamburger meat or it, chicken?
it's more like hamburger, but it can have a wild taste if you don't have like seasoning in it and whatnot. And so I always make like taco meat, which you can't taste it at all, or put in
moose
lasagna.
Tacos.
Yeah, moose tacos. or put it in like spaghetti kind of thing.
Rob, our viewers probably can't imagine Alex shooting. But me and Deepon have seen Alex go in a beast mode.
Oh yes, we have.
And oh my god, man. I like now anytime you know it's Alex real. Talks about shooting, I just imagine her in that mode and I'm like, yep, can shoot.
She can do it. And then Rav, how's your life been?
Same. Nothing's changed.
Done.
That's good.
No more, no comment. No more.
Okay, wait, one thing. I'm probably an expert at Banff.
Yes.
Oh my gosh.
I can be a tourist at Banff right now and Jasper because
I've
been
how many
there.
Times have you been to Banff National Park in Alberta in 2020?
I think more than me now because
I think
even I've lived here.
Six times. Okay. I went six times to
this year.
Banff, yes.
Yeah.
And I've been to three times to Jasper.
And one of those times was dragging me there.
Yeah.
I think I spent this whole break just catching up with family, lots of family, just seeing my sister, like still decorating my new house, still waiting for my dining table to come on in after like 5 months. Yeah. And then I do want to put in a plug right now for all of our listeners. You might have seen on social media that all the Ontario optometrists are going through a job action right now. We'll put in links in our description box for the Save Eye Care website, the Ontario Optometrists Association, and just for you guys to like learn more about what's going on and how you can support us if you are interested. But that definitely has affected my job for the whole month. So even though Ontario is not on lockdown right now, my work is basically like February, March when we were in lockdown. I think I see like one patient a day right now or two.
Yeah, that's what I was just gonna ask you. Like, is your so since you're not, you guys are refusing OHIP still, right?
So yeah, so we're refusing to see government funded eye exams right now.
So now you're just seeing basically full eye exams,
full pay,
right?
Mm-hmm.
Right. Okay,
so it's like private pay, out of pocket patients.
Are but people getting like really mad, like the seniors?
No, it's really good. It's, you know, where our patients are getting frustrated, especially seniors. Mm-hmm. Parents are getting pissed off too, because obviously when their kids have an eye infection, we are rerouting those patients to the emergency room at the hospital, which no one wants to go to, their family doctor, which doesn't know what the hell to do with an infected eyelid.
They give Tobradex for everything.
Yeah, Tobradex for everything. And then we tell the family doctors to make a referral to ophthalmology, because obviously we can't refer if we don't see the patient for an eye exam. And that has been causing a lot of pissed off patients in Ontario, which is good. So I think over, you know, 300,000, almost 400,000 patients have signed the petitions, gone on the website. They're calling the local MPPs. So like the people who are, you know, in charge of each municipality and region in Ontario. Like when you see the public's reaction to our job action, it's very, very, very supportive. Like every single person that knows about job action is like, yeah, why are you guys being underpaid? Like, it's just, it just doesn't make sense. So that's happening now. I feel like this month was so slow, but my mentality during job action was all this free time, enjoy it, because again, it's not coming back. Like every day I work for like 30 minutes or an hour and then I'm done for the day. So yeah, I'm really enjoying this time though. I'm reading books. I am proud of myself. I wrote two articles for the COVD Digital Journal. They were both approved for publishing, which is really good. So I spent I just like kind of tried to be productive, but I also spent a lot of hours this month being super lazy, like just sitting on my sofa, wrapped in a blanket, candle lit, just eating and like watching TV or reading a book.
That's nice.
It was nice. Yeah. So now we should get into our actual episode. Let's start diving into the topic of our episode today. So we are doing basically another new grad case reflection. So just to remind you guys, when we do our case reflections, we're not really going into like details of like the patient's diagnosis per se. We're just kind of summarizing how we approach that patient and the case and what we did, you know, what we did well, what we could have improved on. And we just discuss how all four of us would have handled a case like this, just so that everyone feels more connected and no one feels like they're, you know, lost as a new practitioner and a new optometrist. So I wanted to talk about an interesting case that I had a few months ago that I will probably never forget in my entire life, because it was the first time I've ever reported suspected child abuse. I've already spoken about this case with the girls before, but you know, I wanted to go over it on the podcast because I think this topic, I don't hear a lot about it, you know, on optometry podcasts or optometry resources. I think it's just a really nice thing to keep in mind, you know, if you ever do end up with a child in front of you that might be getting abused. So I wanted to quickly just define child maltreatment and what categories of maltreatment are. Child neglect is often the main cause of child abuse case or child maltreatment cases. Roughly about 40% of cases in Canada that are reported are often due to neglect, then followed by physical abuse, sexual abuse, and even emotional maltreatment. That one interested me the most when I was researching this, just because emotional maltreatment cases were the highest percent of substantiated cases, meaning that most reports of emotional mistreatment actually were legit reports. Emotional maltreatment basically means, you know, just, you know, the parent is verbally threatening a child or just putting them down, being intimidating to the child, or just terrorizing them. I was trying to search how many, you know, cases per year are reported for child abuse in the US and Canada. The US has an updated report in 2019. Over 650,000 cases of maltreatment were reported just in 2019. Canada, I found a study only dating 1998. So I didn't really find any. I mean, there's probably a report. I didn't Google too deep into it, so I couldn't find one, but you know, there were 135,000 reports made just that year. And even in that year, you know, in Canada, 42% of those cases were actually legit, where the information was looked into and the child was actually being abused. Now, general signs to look for overall, if there's physical harm, of course, you'll find, you know, signs of bruises, cuts, burns, broken bones, head trauma, and of course, death. A Canadian study interestingly reported that the biological mother is the most common suspect in neglect in general, while both biological parents are often the suspects for emotional maltreatment, where relatives are the most common suspects for sexual abuse. So it's just interesting to keep that in mind too. Other common characteristics of a child being maltreated, having developmental delays or disabilities, if there was a history of substance abuse during birth or any birth-related substance abuse defects, if the child has depression, anxiety, or other psychiatric disorders or behavioral problems, and if they have any self-harming behavior. You might even want to look into the child's cleanliness of their clothes, their hair, their skin, and their nails. That might give you any hints that there's some neglect. And then there was a PowerPoint presentation by an optometrist, Dr. Angela Howell. I think she's an OD in Arkansas. I found her presentation online. It was like a PDF version. So I'll put that link in our description as well for anyone who wants to review it. It's a really good one. She has like ocular findings for abuse, and then she even shares some case reports that are really interesting. So again, ocular findings that may get you suspicious for child abuse would include bruises to the orbital rim, lids, and adnexa, subconchemes, which can often occur after choking or vomiting, retinal hemes, of course. I think that's the most common one that a lot of people know from shaken baby syndrome. Now, if you do find a retinal heme, instead of jumping to the conclusion first that there might be abuse, you also want to consider ruling out leukemia, sickle cell disease, and even diabetic retinopathy in a child. If there's sexual abuse, you may find pubic lice on their eyelashes, or you might have signs of sexually transmitted diseases causing conjunctivitis, so like gonorrhea or chlamydia. Right. For those, you guys want to check out our STD episode that we had with Dr. Mika Moy and Dr. Sandra Harpster. That was a really good episode. So you guys can check out on that. So I just wanted to kind of give that background information before I started off on my case. So now I'll just kind of jump right into, you know, what kind of brought me to suspect that there was any sort of abuse. So I had I think like a 14, 15 year old girl come into the office for a regular eye exam, and she came in with her mom. Mom was also present during the eye exam for the whole time. And the daughter complained that she had blurry vision in one eye after she hit her head on an object at home, like a piece of furniture. As an optometrist, of course, you ask all the questions for head trauma. You know, did you lose consciousness? What were you doing? Any other concussion signs or symptoms like vomiting, nausea, any other ocular signs? And a lot of the answers were very vague. It was, you know, I don't remember how I hit my head. I don't know what I was doing. It just happened. And, you know, the mom kind of answered the same way. So I kind of let it go. And I mean, actually at that point, what would you girls do if that was already the presentation in the beginning? How would you feel if you weren't getting those direct answers the first time you're asking the case history?
Honestly, I would probably brush it off, but put a note in her chart saying answers were really vague, or actually put in the chart what they said. But yeah, for sure. I know I wouldn't think of possible neglect or any sort of abuse for sure. I would just be like, that was kind of off. And then I would just put that in the chart.
And I would even think maybe possible concussion, because maybe mom wasn't around, or, you know, something like that. But I probably wouldn't have thought of neglect or anything.
Yeah.
And yeah, let me clarify. Sorry. I didn't jump to the conclusion of abuse, but I also just felt like something is off in this room. Like I don't feel comfortable in this room. Like something's wrong. I don't know what it is, but something.
You had that like gut feeling, right? Where there's like,
that's what it was.
Something's off about this. Yeah.
But the daughter reported that immediately after bumping her head, her vision immediately went blurry in one eye. And then I asked, well, when did this happen? 3 weeks ago. So that kind of made me just a little nervous. I was like, oh God, like what, like, why didn't you come? Like if your eye is blurry, just, you should have came right away. So, you know, we do the eye exam. She's about 20/80 in the left eye, 20/20 in the right. She did have, you know, at first I thought it was, she was just malingering because her RX was Plano in the right eye and like minus 0.5 in the left. And she was 20/20, going from 20/80 to 20/20 with minus 0.5. Obviously I was kind of like, do I really believe you? Maybe you just want glasses, right? But I did a lot of her accommodative testing, out of phoropter and infraopter, and a lot of her accommodation was asymmetric as well. And they all my testing kind of lined up. So at that point I said, okay, I don't think you're malingering. Maybe you really are just, you're having a really bad accommodative response to the bump on the head. Right. And then throughout the exam, the patient started bringing up that she hit her head again, two more times in that exact same spot on different occasions. within that 3-week period?
I feel like I would think, I still wouldn't think abuse. Mm-hmm. In my head, I would think like maybe she had a concussion. Mm-hmm. There is some sort of mobility, or she can't walk straight, and that's why she's falling over and tripping. And I would be like, okay, let's go get you an MRI. I still wouldn't be like, oh, it's abuse.
Yeah. Yeah. I thought the same thing, and I did explain that to her. I said, you know, you may have had concussion symptoms. Mm-hmm. You had a super asymmetric VA. Yeah. So I'm assuming your balance is probably just really off now. Mm-hmm. So, you know, you're probably just falling more because of your vision. So I actually did prescribe her glasses, because, you know, at the end of the day, I trial framed it. VAs were 20/20 in both eyes. She said she felt better. I gave her the glasses. I made a note of all the other times she hit her head. And at that point, I still just had a gut feeling that something just wasn't right based on how the patient was reacting to my questions and how mom was responding to my questions.
I just want to know, while you were in the exam room and you were talking to the patient, I don't know if you saw the mom the entire time, but was she like present during the exam, like watching you, or was she kind of on her phone, or just like...
Mom was on her phone a lot. So mom was texting a lot. And I think the daughter was answering most of the questions, but if the daughter didn't have an answer or hesitated, mom would lift her head and look up and try to answer the question for her. Mm-hmm. And then again, I think mom just kind of brushed off the multiple hits to the head. Mm-hmm. She just said, you know, she's really clumsy. She just had a little goose egg, you know, she's fine. She didn't have any concussion symptoms. Mm-hmm. And I said, well, you know, it's still worrisome, you know, and, you know, you try to talk to them to kind of let them know, like, you're not, like, you're still worried about them, because sometimes patients don't want to share information because they're embarrassed or shy or, you know, upset. And so I kind of talked to them too, like, you know, I just want to know more information because, you know, these things could happen the more times you bump your head. So, you know, I just want to know everything so that we can make sure that this doesn't happen again. Mm-hmm. And even after still kind of having that sort of a conversation, a lot of the answers were still pretty vague. She comes back for her follow-up. She loves the glasses. She says her vision feels much better. She's 20/20 in them. Her accommodation is better, much, much better. But she bumped her head about 2 to 3 more times within the month, even with her glasses, and in the exact same spot. And she will localize where she bumped her head, and it would be in the exact same spot mostly each time. So I asked the same questions. It's very repetitive now, very vague answers. Or she would, you know, bump her head, you know, walking into a door. She bumped her head on the same piece of furniture again in her home. And then, you know, we ask mom, did you now take her to family doctor? Did you take her to the emergency room? Does she have any other symptoms? And still, they did not seek any other care.
Did you see any like bruising or anything on her head of like any sort or anything? Nothing.
None. I didn't see any bruises on her head or on her arms. Her eyes looked okay. Everything looked fine on the outside, and visual functions were doing well. So, but this story of bumping her head, it's still, now it really didn't sit well with me, because I said, okay, mom's here too. I don't know. I'm not a mom. I can't judge any parent on how you handle your child, but I'm already nervous for you. I want to take you to the hospital if you're bumping your head so many times. Mm-hmm. Like, why? It's just a question of why was there no additional care taken? So then at that point, I did ask for the family doctor's information. And I just said, you know, I'm grabbing at straws. Is there any medical history? Do you have any history of iron deficiency, nutritional deficiency, anything? Like, why are you bumping your head so many times? Why are you falling so many times? And she did mention she may have had some sort of muscle disorder or muscle issue that was getting looked into with the family doctor. Mm-hmm. So I said, great, perfect. Like, fine. This is one thing that, like, maybe this is just why you're falling. So at this point, now how do you girls feel? Second follow-up, still bumping her head. No additional care was taken. Vague answers.
I feel like my mind would be like some sort of like pituitary adenoma or pituitary tumor, like
still something like a neurological condition.
Yeah, like something that's affecting her peripheral vision. That's why she keeps bumping on one side only. Still, my mind doesn't go towards abuse.
Yeah,
I feel like I'm just so wired into thinking why you're only bumping on one side. It has to be vision related, right?
Sometimes she bumped her head on the other side as well.
Oh, okay.
Most of the time it was on the left side. I think 2 out of maybe the 5 or 6 times it was the right side.
And then I agree with Rav too.
She does have a medical history. She is in the medical field.
She is in the medical field.
So that's why I feel like I would be like, oh, okay, the mother is in medical field, so she would know what's best for her child.
Yes.
Yeah. And of course, you know, you can, as a medical person, you can kind of make a judgment a bit better than somebody who's not in the medical field. So I feel like I would still be like, okay, like, you know, maybe it's just,
yeah.
I still wouldn't think abuse at this point.
So yeah, actually, I was discussing this with my colleague who works with me at that clinic, who brought up an interesting point that I didn't think of. She was assuming that this child might have just been self-harming. She may just be wanting attention from her parents. Maybe it's, you know, a family home that, you know, she's really struggling in. So it's likely not abuse, but it does sound like patterns of self-harm. So then again, I that kind of opened my eyes and I was like, oh, I never really assumed that. And I was like, well, what do we do if it's self-harm? Like, do you report that? Can you do anything? Like, how do you help this person if they're a child and they're harming themselves?
And I guess I think of self-harm usually as a like cutting or like, I think of like, not
other acts. Stereotype.
Yeah. Other acts basically of them hitting their head. But
yeah. So, and so at that point I said, you know what? I decided to contact the family doctor because my colleague was also recommending, you know, you want to, if you have access to the family doctor or another healthcare professional who's seen that patient, it would be helpful to reach out to them to express your concerns and see if there's any obvious repeated patterns of behavior with the other healthcare professionals. And I was like, yeah, that's a great idea, because I'm just sitting alone at, you know, in that clinic with all of these observations simmering in me, and I don't know what to do with them. I need someone else to discuss this with, to see if this is even worth reporting. Because again, I think we all get nervous to make those reports. It's such a big deal. You don't want to just make a report, you know, like out of the blue. So I did contact the family doctor. The family doctor, I shared my observations with them, and the family doctor did make note that the same patient returned to her clinic multiple times for the same fractured ankle over the past year. So the same ankle would break over and over again. And the family doctor did refer her to multiple like orthopedic doctors or like muscle and bone doctors to kind of see if there's any joint issues, any arthritis, any bone disorders, and all of the patient's testing would come back normal. So the family doctor also didn't really have any, like any reason for the fractured ankles. It was just, you know, foul, like playing around and falling and breaking her leg. So at that point, even the family doctor heard my observations and said, okay, now this sounds a little concerning because these all sound like repeated behaviors. But the family doctor knew the mom very well, obviously, because the patient would come see them quite often. And the family doctor said, well, usually when she breaks her ankle, mom would bring her in right away. But it sounds very unusual that she's bumping her head frequently and mom's not bringing her in right away. So again, now this is a change in the mother's behavior that's not consistent. So, you know, at that point, I think that gave me enough information to make me feel like my feelings are validated now. Like my gut instincts are real. Something is wrong. I don't know what's wrong, but something is. It's just not adding up. And no matter what's happening, you know, that girl shouldn't be bumping her head anymore, because it's, that's really going to damage her and hurt her. So, what would you girls do now? Like, do you finally think with all that information that this is enough to suspect, child maltreatment, mistreatment, or any sort of abuse? Or would you still maybe like hold back on that and do any further investigation?
I think after talking to the primary care doctor, I'd probably report it.
The only thing, yeah, the only thing I'd be nervous about is what the next steps would be. Like, I would have to get help in terms of like, okay, what do I do? How do I word this properly? Like, do I need a lawyer to read over this? Like, what yeah, do I, these how, are all my how questions. Can I do this properly where I'm not legally going to get into trouble? Yeah. So, yeah.
That's like every single thing that went through my mind, because I was hesitating. At this point, it was about 2.5 months since my first encounter with her. So I already delayed this pretty long because I was like, I don't want to report. It's scary. Yeah. I don't want to do it. I don't want to ruin this girl's family. I don't want to ruin her own life. I don't want to do anything that'll ruin someone if it wasn't true. Like if it wasn't needed. So this was a huge learning process for me, and I'm really happy that I can like share this case with everyone, because I think it'll make everyone feel more comfortable and confident with reporting. So I did decide that I was going to report. I had to literally Google how to report child abuse, because you know, everywhere online in optometry, it'll say you have a duty to report. And then you ask, okay, who do I report to?
Think that's what we learned in school too. It was like, yeah, you have that obligation to report, but then there's nothing.
But then there's nothing after that.
Yeah. And it's, that's like, the where? Most important part of the whole situation.
Yeah. So you want to contact your local Children's Aid Society in Canada. In the States, you want to contact local Child Protective Services. So for Canada, your Children's Aid Society, just type in Children's Aid and your city, and you'll definitely find the phone number for that. In the States, I think you can do the same thing, Child Protective Services with your state. There's also a Child Help National Abuse Hotline for the States. So I'll even put that phone number in the description box. They have like a lot of resources on that number if you want to report. Or you can call the police if you do feel that the child is in immediate danger. So I contacted Children's Aid and I literally said, I'm an optometrist. I think there's suspected child abuse with a patient, but I don't know how to report. So can you please tell me what I need to do? And they are super nice. They're really, really helpful, because obviously they're in a profession that deals with a lot of sensitive situations. So those people will definitely make sure you feel comfortable and you know what you're doing. So basically, what happens when you make a report? Nothing. Nothing happens when you make a report. And that's the number one thing that I had no idea about. I assume that when you make a report, sirens go off, police come in, grab the child, bring them to like some sort of foster care, and like they're broken up from their family forever, and the families are gonna like get a lawyer and sue you for doing that. I swear, like that's literally how I felt. But
your shirt says nothing. What happens?
Nothing was the same after I reported. Nothing was the same. Okay. Basically, so when you want to report, call your aid society or protective services and just tell them your observations. They just want to know every single detail. What did the child look like? What made you suspicious? What are all the observations? Tell me everything. And they write it all down. Once you're done reporting, I don't know if this is the same in the US, but you do have the option to report anonymously, or you can actually share your information as a healthcare professional. Because you are a doctor. So, you know, if they need any access to medical reports, or I think if they need more information, and then they say, we're going to review this and we'll let you know if it's actually something valid that we should look into. So I think that was the biggest sigh of relief when I reported for the first time, because she said, no, we are not contacting the mom. Like, don't worry. We're not going to go to their home. We have a team of individuals who review all your information. Then they use their database to actually search the patient to see if there's been any other reports in the past, because obviously the more reports, then the more suspicious they get. If this is the first report they've ever had, they really have to dig deep into the information to decide if it's even worth looking into, because most of the time it doesn't sound as serious as you think it is, because these people hear about these things all day. So they really know what's serious and what's not. So that actually made me feel much better. And hopefully with everyone listening, that makes you feel much more confident in just reporting any of your gut instincts and suspicions. You will not be penalized for it. They might not even do, they might laugh at you and just be like, nah, bruh, that's nothing. It's fine. like, so it'll make you feel better, and just do it. Just report anything you have. You never know. Some of that information, of course, you know, we said 40% of reported cases are often true of like what's happening, and they're substantiated. So yeah, you should be reporting anything that you find suspicious. I felt better. I felt relief, because I said, you know what, maybe they're not even going to look into this, so it's fine. So they'll just tell me you're just overthinking and it's fine. About 30 minutes later, I got a call from Children's Aid again, asking for the patient's contact information, because they did look it over and they said, this sounds pretty serious and we want to contact the family within 24 hours. I felt pretty scared, but I felt really good, because I said, you know what? I sat on this gut feeling for like 2.5 months, and Children's Aid thought in 30 minutes that it was worth looking into. So I am really glad that I reported, even though I was super nervous. But after that, they don't contact you and tell you like what happened, because this is all confidential, right? This is, you just make the report and then you're done. That's the main information that I really wanted to share with everyone, to know that it is okay to report. You should be reporting. When my association contacted me back finally, after I already made the report, the lady who I was speaking with, she was glad that I reported, because she did say, you know, we don't have a lot of optometrists making reports. And sometimes that is a little concerning. Like, there's such a low percentage of healthcare professionals in general that make reports. Most of the time, reports are coming from teachers and like educational professionals. And that was surprising to me, because I thought healthcare professionals would really be like the main ones. And that's probably because we're all scared to share our observations and suspicions. But now that we know, you do not get penalized for anything. So that's why I contacted my association, because I was really nervous. You know, what if the family finds out that I reported? What, you know, what can they do? Will they find me? Will they bring a lawyer? You know, do I need a lawyer? Anytime anyone reports suspicions of child abuse, no lawyer can ever get to you. You are protected by federal laws. You will never, ever be sued or penalized for reporting suspicions at all, like ever. Of course, unless they find out that, if you were literally reporting for like malicious, like to be malicious, like, if you do it out of bad faith, yes, you will get penalized, I'm sure. But no, like, no one would ever do that. So you're all,
I hope not.
I hope not.
You never know, man.
Yeah.
The world is crazy.
I mean, yeah, but like, that's the thing. Like, everyone knows you're reporting out of good faith. You're not saying the parents are awful. All you're saying is this child looks like they need help, whether it's the parents harming them, them harming themselves, or they're just not in a good environment, that someone needs to look at that child and figure out if they need help. And so you will never be penalized for reporting going through that case. Is there anything else that you would have done? Do you want to add anything? Would you have done anything else differently?
I think I would want to know more of the ocular signs from that PDF you were talking about, because I feel like that would be a good thing to know, just to keep in mind. Like, if you already have a gut feeling of something that's wrong, and then you see one of these ocular signs during your examination, yeah. then that's kind of like, and then if you ask further questions about that to the parents, and if you're not getting straight mm-hmm. answers, then it's like, yeah. Cause I think when, even when we had our episode with Dr. Alexopoulos too, yeah, she mentioned Dr. signs as well, mm-hmm. In that episode.
So I feel like what you're saying is bringing up a really good point. I kind of feel like optometrists are not reporting suspicions of child mistreatment because we're looking for the ocular signs,
yeah.
right? Because mm-hmm. even for me, like I was looking for ocular signs for this head trauma. I was like, oh, concussion, multiple concussions. Mm-hmm. Okay. Does she have any, like any hemorrhaging? Mm-hmm. Does she have any bruises? And I didn't see any of that. But again, I think that's where it's hard for optometrists to remember like signs of child mistreatment. Like the most common type of mistreatment is emotional maltreatment. Mm-hmm. I mean, the parents just speaking in a way to a child that is terrorizing them, intimidating them, threatening them. And like, you know, I mean, even in different cultures, like we see that all the time. But mm-hmm. like, if you're even seeing just the interaction between your patient and their parent, if it already feels uncomfortable for you, that's probably a sign that something's not right or something needs to be looked into, even if they don't have those ocular signs.
Yeah. I also think you talking to the other healthcare professional about stuff mm-hmm. was that would kind of really push me to report something if yeah. I contacted their other healthcare professionals and they were like, yeah, I've been noticing similar things. Yeah. I just, again, like we don't, that's not the first thing that comes to our mind. You know, that's the last thing I want to think about. Cause again, mm-hmm. like you said, I don't want to ruin anything at home or
yeah.
I don't know what's going on. I just want to make sure that this is absolutely the right decision when, you know, you're reporting. So, yes. you know, you have to check all those boxes to make sure. Right. So
when you're collaborating with other healthcare professionals, if you guys all, you know, share your observations and decide, yes, this sounds suspicious and we should report, the we is important to remember. You are responsible to make your own report. Mm-hmm. You can be penalized if you had suspicions and you did not report. So, I could not rely on the family physician to make a report and just say, yeah, I spoke with her and she's going to make the report. So I don't need to. It's actually more evidence for children's aid when there are multiple reports.
Mm-hmm. Yeah.
And so obviously if the family doctor chose to report and I chose to report, I think that would give more incentive for them to really look into this.
That makes sense. Yeah, that definitely makes sense.
So and then, always report yourself. Don't rely on anyone to do it for you.
And then I also want to just make a comment about when we're thinking about abuse, not only think about kids, also think about your seniors. Or, mm-hmm. you know, we see a lot of patients with like dementia mm-hmm. or some sort of condition where they have a caretaker. And a lot of the time, like those caretakers are your spouses or your kids, right? Sometimes, you know, like when you ask them questions, they don't know much about what medications the patient's on. And it's like, you know, okay, like you're the caretaker, you should be knowing this. Mm-hmm. And the reason why I say this is just because my husband, Harv, dealt with a case like this before where he suspected an abuse. So the wife had dementia and he suspected some sort of abuse. You know, the wife had a kind of like broken arm. She was just not in the right condition.
Yeah.
And when the further investigation happened, it turned out the husband was actually not giving her medication for dementia, and her dementia got significantly worse in a few years.
Oh my gosh.
And like, you know, if no action was taken, like this lady would have been thinking, the whole family thought like, oh, the husband is taking care of her. And mm-hmm. like, you know, it's hard when you have a patient with dementia, right? Like it's a full-time job. Yeah. And that the lady was getting mistreated and she was not getting the care. Nobody knew what was happening behind closed doors, right? Like,
yeah.
So
who do we report to then Same. At that point?
I am looking that up right now. So I think
for like seniors or.
I think for elder abuse, because I know child abuse is we are mandatory reporters.
Yeah.
Elder abuse, I feel like this will vary between province and state. I don't think elder abuse is mandatory to report unless they, I'm looking at the Ontario, unless they are living in a retirement home or a community home, then it is mandatory to report abuse. But if they're living, you know, in their own family home, it's actually not mandatory to report it, but you can still call your police department. There are provincial helplines, long-term care action lines. Yeah, there's a lot.
Yeah, that's a good point, Rav. For those people who are unable to care for themselves and have to rely on someone else, they can also experience the situation that Amrit just talked about. And that is true. We can't forget about them as well. It's not only children that experience this. So
yeah,
good point.
One thing that I learned from this case of how I can handle it better next time, if we were initially suspecting that the child may be harming herself, I should have, or I could have separated the mom from the daughter and spoke to the mom privately to just say, you know, things like, you know, this behavior sounds very unusual. Is this unusual for her? Like, what, you know, how is she at home? Is there anything that's changed in the home that might be, you know, influencing her behaviors? Is there any change in dynamic, school, her friends, her social group? Like, did something change at all for her to start bumping her head? That's something that I still don't have the confidence to do, because even the mom was very intimidating and the mom also wasn't really providing clarity to a lot of answers. So I felt super uncomfortable. I wanted to leave that exam room, like from the moment case history started, like I didn't feel comfortable. And so I did not have the confidence to, I didn't have the confidence to separate the child from the mom to ask the child questions.
Well, I think it's awkward.
Like,
asking any parent these questions, because you think you're insinuating that, do you think I don't know how to take care of my kid? Exactly. Like, why are you asking me these questions? Because sometimes I'll be in an exam room, and if I do have a patient that's malingering or their results are out of whack or nothing's making sense, I'll literally turn to the parent and be like, is he or she under a lot of stress at school? Like, is there anything going on at home? And the only response I'll always get is, no, nothing's going on at home. Like, why would they be under stress? And if they get very defensive right away. Mm-hmm. That's from my experience, you know?
You know what? So I feel like the way that we could handle that is the way that Dr. Mika Moy actually mentioned it in our STD episode. Because when you're asking patients about STD case history, you know, you don't want to insult them either or embarrass them. So you kind of ask the questions as like a matter of fact, right? It's very like, you know, I want to ask you a few questions. And these questions are literally just so that I can figure out what's going on in your exam, like with the results. So I'm just going to ask you 1, 2, 3.
Yeah.
And just kind of make it like, I just have to ask you these. It's my job. And then,
but
I still don't have the confidence to do that.
You're like, that's what uncomfortable kind of questions are coming up. Yeah. So don't get like disarmed.
I think that's what kind of ends up happening. Cause as soon as I see, you can read the parent's face and you're just like, oh no, like I have to ask this so I can rule certain things out. Then they're like,
I really wanted to get that main information out, because I still think about that case like every day. And that was like, you know, a couple months back. And I feel like that case is something I will remember for the rest of my life with how stressful it was. You know, I think when we think about reporting child abuse, we have all this like weight on our shoulders. Like, oh my God, where someone's life is in our hands and we're going to ruin it like in the snap of our fingers if we say something. And that's not the case at all. So don't be nervous to report, because you could save someone's life just from your own gut instincts. Yeah, that was it. That was our first new grad case reflection after our long ass break. So I hope everyone learned a lot, and I hope everyone just feels more like calm and confident about reporting. If anyone has comments, you know, feel free to message us on Instagram. Like always, you can review our podcast, let us know how we're doing. And yeah, that's it. So we'll see you guys next time, next week, like always.
Bye.
Bye. Bye.